that gateway into the city, and you guys, the book that you're going for on this various, whether it's Everhart or Easton or Apple Grove or whatever it is, that makes it a demonstrable difference when it can be anything that anybody wants. I mean, are we going to put whatever out there? It's just not uniform. It makes a complete difference when we're coming in on that. So we're not suggesting that, you know, where it is, that people have to move it. I guess people are grandfathered in, but certainly going forward, we would like it that, you know, we're not making the problem worse as it relates to removing the double strip and changing it out into something else.
So, Pat, are you saying that those who have it can keep it?
Well,
I mean, if we're going to go to this, we want this to look right. We need to make some changes here and give them some sort of leeway or time, or when we've worked with them, they move that out of there. I mean, we think it's not presentable, it's not presentable. So let's get it switched. I mean, is that what we're proposing? Or, I mean,
well, we're bringing it out for discussion. I think, you know, my position, I would support what the council wants. I think that's clearly a better approach than just allowing it to help now, to the extent that, you know, we can somehow find a way to assist them. Maybe there's a vendor that could provide a discounted rate to those that wanted to do that. Maybe something to that effect.
Just by your knowledge, how many do you think we, I'm not trying to make, you know, test your name, but what do you think, how many do we have in our town? Because we don't want to get ourselves into something that, you know, is too great. So do we have a lot of this?
Well, we have a considerable amount. I mean, you know, what is a lot to you?
Yeah.
Is it, you know, 100 properties?
Okay.
You talk about 100 properties that need some attention.
Talking about, you know, perhaps as many as 100 properties that change the dumpster.
Yeah. Right. But, like, I mean, obviously, they're trying to make it beautiful in their own worldly way. And, you know, what we're looking for is more consistency.
Yeah.
Like, me, my main issue was, it's like, you know, grass grows in the street, or across the sidewalk, or you can't go down the sidewalk because there's all this growth. To me, that's really how my intention of the whole thing. Now, you know, if they already spent money to put these devil strips in, or whatever you want to call them, or pretty rocks or whatever, I understand the hazard point, but did you say the city would be willing to take them out for them?
No, you didn't say that.
I was just double checking because
I didn't say that.
No.
Okay, so what happens is they're going to be upset that they spent all their money beautify it, and now you're digging me on that. So I think that would be the only thing I would probably readjust with this plan. I think I would just say, look, our intentions are to have it look more uniform and neat and tidy, or whatever you want to say it. We would prefer not to have the stones because, you know, people ride their bikes and they slip on a stone, they hurt themselves, or maybe someone with a walker gets stuck on a stone like a grocery store cart. So that would make more sense to me to approach it that way.
But
to dictate and say, take it out. So that's just my.
So you're saying leave what's there.
Well, I'm just
and
saying,
then going forward.
Could we give them a time span to take it out? Like 3 to 5 years?
I would just say that maybe, like, where I saw a lot, and maybe Patrick noticed it, was on Everhart Road.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there was a lot after the road. The place looked real sloppy because probably people stayed away from the construction area because it was dangerous. Well, now that that's done, we used a special polymer, so it's going to be a great road for many years. I think it's important with the skinny sidewalks, like Daryl said, when we talk about it, they weren't the normal size you see now. I just think that we need to educate our constituents that, look, you know, this is maybe an example of what we'd like to see, and over time we'd like to see everything look that good, because this is the main entry point into the city. And I don't know if I would just see how it goes, and then if we have to reevaluate the legislation to address that, maybe we do that. That's just my thought. But again, you guys make the decision on 107.
So would there be a way on those main entrance roads, so whether it's Everhart or Portage or the main thoroughfares, that possibly the city would take care of those? And then the other ones, because I think, Mark, to your point, if we did the 3 to 5 years, then they have to manage all those people, and then if something moves, it just, I think, becomes a paperwork issue. But then, so everybody else, if it's not on those main thoroughfares, it is what it is. But going forward, the legislation kicks in, you know, not do that anymore. But for us as a city, it may be worth our while to remove those main thoroughfare double strips and make those areas at least look
As we go north and south, we're taking the sidewalks, eliminating the grass, and making it concrete because it's less maintenance. So is that something feasible down the road? Maybe, maybe not. We can look into it, but I was just saying, I believe we'll open a can of worms with dealing with taking, you know, we don't like your rocks, or we don't like your moss, or we don't like whatever. I understand why.
But you're saying that right now, when you're denying anyone else to do it, you're saying right there that we don't like that, we don't want that to happen. So why would we let that, the other people continue to do that? The other people are just going to say, well, Mrs. So-and-so has it, why can't I have it?
You have something that's like anything else. Like, I might keep my yard nice and tidy, but the neighbors may not, because it's not important to them. But it's important to the neighborhood to keep things nice. It helps, you know, it's beautiful, it's enticing, it helps real estate values, it helps your property value,
it helps you
feel like a neighborhood that people want to live in. And I'm just saying that from a real estate standpoint, I'm just saying as a common sense standpoint, you know, I try to set the example of how I want my yard to look. That doesn't guarantee you're going to do it, but I'm just saying, if enough of us do it, and we set some practical guidelines, and maybe even show some examples of what we're meaning, because believe it or not, a lot of people are busy and they don't want to be bothered. It's like out of sight, out of mind. But we know as it's a main corridor coming into the city, which we know those streets are, I would pay attention to those first. And if we have to get a little more involved, then we do that. You know, but I think it's an education thing. Like I said, we have the water bill, we have the quarterly newsletter, you know, so we can start educating people and then setting examples as well.
It's too wishy-washy. It's either you're going to
go forward. Yeah, that's why you can say in the name.
You're going to go forward.
As far as I'm concerned, my roads are named Fairfield, you know, race. So I don't see how you can say some roads and not the other. I don't really think how you can just leave them.
I'm talking about Maple or Eastern.
I think there's certain roads.
And Everhard Road, and I would say Cleveland Avenue, and I would say Portage, and I would say Apple Grove. I would say I would start there first. And see, what triggered this whole thing is, and I asked Pat about this, and Daryl, you know what I'm talking about. Everhard Road was horrible. Am I right?
Yeah.
And when you went down Everhard Road after we had that talk, what did you see?
Well, I saw it was the opposite. It was depressing.
Did you hear that?
The sidewalks were 42-inch sidewalks were reduced to 12 inches because of the overgrowth, and some curbs you couldn't see. And just because there were changes to the double strip didn't eliminate the maintenance of them. Mm-hmm. And there were still weeds growing up through them, regardless of the base that was put in there. So
I guess, you know, my thinking is that
one thing that at least we've noticed, I think when you see it on the main entryways, like Everhard, Portage, especially where there's like four lanes. Because when you think about it, you've got all that traffic, 30,000 cars, which road it is a day. And then when there's snow plowing, all that stone, and that's where I think you see it at the entryway at Portage. It's very heavy along there. Coming up Everhard, you see it? I mean, I had walked down there, and Councilman Revolt is the one that called me and said, you gotta take a look at it. And it was just nothing but along the sidewalk, just debris and snow. You know, it was in the spring after all the snow fall. And then Portage was another area. Washington Square, but there's not much of a, that's been pretty good. That hasn't been a problem, but there's a lot of traffic and entryway there. And then also, the ones that stand out in my mind where we've had the complaints is Portage and Everhard.
Yeah.
I agree.
Right?
Yeah. They're a mess. And
that's why Dr. Thomas's office, you can just walk down there. And it could be because, you know, they're bringing debris from areas where roads that weren't paved, and there's a lot of, you know, gravel and stone. And so we just went out and we would clean it up. I mean, even the sidewalk was, there's no way one person could.
I guess all we can do is try to figure out how we can refine it and make less regulation or more. You know, make it just, like I said, it's just common sense.
I think less regulation is why there's a problem that we have right now. I think it's always intended that the double strip is just another name for the the long strip predisposes it's to be maintained, such as the lawn. And simply because we didn't go the extra mile and add that extra part to the legislation stating that the lawn strip should contain what's viewed as a lawn and not be filled with gravel or mulch or something along that line, felt some residents had the opportunity, well, it's difficult to maintain, perhaps, or it's easier if I put a liner down and gravel or something along those lines. But I think you run the risk of the unfairness of those stating, well, I live along one of these roads, that's the entryway, and now I have a higher standard than those of the others in the neighborhood. Other neighborhoods, and that's unfair. We're not asking anything more from those that live along those areas than we are than others. This is part of home ownership, is to maintain your property, and I can imagine similar arguments from businesses that perhaps in our mind we hold those that are in the Main Street Business District to a higher standard.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Other businesses would make that complaint that I'm not being treated fairly. It's a constitutional argument, but I hope we don't go down that path with someone on
the grass strip.
To say something that Tim was saying here, because this weekend somebody came up, a good friend of mine came up to me. They had children, and they're looking for a home for their children. They live in a town close to ours here, and it was kind of interesting what they said to me. They said that our son, we told our son, why don't you look for a house in North Canton? Because they have a lot of nice starter homes, and they have regulations that make sure that people keep them nice. Because where they live, people park anywhere, people have whatever they want in their house, they put a tree house in the middle, in the front yard, things like that that they don't allow. But that's when they said it to me, you know what? That's right. And that's why people want it. One of the reasons why. So when you start saying you want to release certain regulations, be careful what you're asking.
Well, I didn't mean release. I'm just saying I just need more clarity. Like, don't make it more cumbersome. Just make it clean and easy. And when he said grass strip, that didn't happen with me.
Yeah.
Instead of a devil strip or this strip or that strip, it's a grass strip maintaining like your yard, and we like it look uniform or something like that. That makes sense to me. That's all I said.
I don't have time to clarify words. 553.01 prohibits homeowners from hauling debris in the street. What we're really saying, we're asking for two things here. The first is, I guess this is thumbs up or thumbs down, do we want to require homeowners to maintain their sidewalks? I mean, you already can't blow it into the street. We don't want you to blow it into the sidewalk where it becomes part of the natural vegetation. So that's question A. Is that something we want to do? Just kind of looking at this is what the language is.
Does it mean replacing the cement?
That's the second question. Okay, so the first question is, do we want to prevent the encroachment of the ground cover? I think the answer is yes. So at a minimum, we want to add C to existing A and B. Then we have D. And D says lawn strips shall be maintained in the same manner as lawns. Is that something you want to do?
Yes.
You can't differentiate between one street or the other. It is we're gonna create one standard for everybody.
That's
going forward. And we're gonna do it going forward.
And that's
it.
Well,
then there needs to be a time where the other people have to
conform. That would be a good point.
A certain amount of 3-5 years.
You're never going to be able to keep track of that.
Why would you? Because again, the nuisance person would still go around.
That's the same.
Yeah. I think it's either the grass or a brick or concrete that supervisor. Someone could come and say, yeah, you can do this. That's the only alternative. No gravel, no kind of vegetation. There's trees that are planted in certain areas. Let's face it. On some of our nicer tree canopy streets, so
forth. I think there needs, we need to take control of this.
Well, to Doug's point, this question that I have is if we're going to require grass, we want to create an exception for brick only, which is what we have in Main Street. Or do we want to allow people to plant flowers? And there's actually a reason why people do plant flowers, is because there's so much road soil out there that makes grass difficult.
Right.
So they come in and they can throw some soil down and then you've got something puts in.
Right.
But just those kind of trash in
there. Well, of course, some of the flowers are pretty good.
I've heard that before, 90% of people grow grass there.
Okay.
So it's not.
No, we call it weeds.
Okay, so it is our fault. We want to add D that says it's going to be grass. And if it is, do we want to make it, I mean, if you've got lava stone right now, we're telling you that you can no longer have lava stone.
Or if they have brick, we're telling them to take off.
I think the brick looks nice on Portage.
But you've got brick out here, though, right, which is going to be a problem. See,
well, where your stuff is.
But so is it out of the country calls, somebody has brick.
Right?
Yes. Where's the reason you did that? The dentist
strip
over on Portage.
Right. Half or less. And even that to grow grass better because of the salt.
Sure. On Main Street, we eliminated that through the streetscape process. There is no double strip, dead strip. We have taken that out as a city from one end of the town to the other on Main Street. So, there, yes, there is brick, but that's not a problem. Those businesses are there. We did that. We changed that.
Which is the thing.
Right, but I think what he's saying is we have brick. Why wouldn't we allow other people to have brick? Yeah, is that what you're saying?
I'm trying to pay attention to what our language says is that lawn strips shall be maintained the same manner as lawns. We have businesses on South Main Street, particularly that have lawns. So you want to create an exception for brick.
What would that normal?
That would be the only exception.
But what about the reason we have concrete? There's like other nice factors. Like what?
When we have burnt down, right, and you know our experience on Main Street with it is that when it's not properly installed,
that's correct.
Right.
It's a manhole, and we're going to allow who to install that? And how is it going to be installed? And are we just creating more uneven walking surfaces?
And keep in mind, you do have some people that are, you know, their top priority is their lawn. And I can think of a couple of homes where they've got a great lawn and their double strip is not grass. They placed brick or they placed flowers.
I know.
So the thing is that you just have to. Just saying, you don't want, you know, somebody that has a beautiful lawn, they take care of it, they're on top of it, it's like, oh, gotta have grass. Tear up the roots.
Well, there needs to be some time.
Make away with it today.
Make away
with it. And really, what we're looking for is we want the homes to be presentable, right? I mean, that's what the goal is. We want the homes to be presentable. It's not like we necessarily want to, you know, so it becomes a challenge to, you know, to find what is presentable. But maybe before we start defining what that is, just take a look at what we have now along some of those places.
It's like loose impediments, vegetation. I mean, you can word things, so there's leeway.
I mean, let's prepare this legislation. We will require the maintenance item C, which was in the document, and we always amended the language for D and the lawn strips if we want grass or something else. But we can think about it over the next 2 weeks. We'll start the process.
Yeah. Okay.
Is that fair?
Yeah.
And we can add that amendment D. If you will drive around and give some thought, I would also say that if we're going to go to grass, give some thought to the practical consideration of how we bring those folks into compliance. I know we've got some guy who's got a couple tons of lava stone, I'm sure. So what are we going to do about it? Are we going to make him haul it off? Are we going to be a farm? Or what are we going to do? So let's think about how we solve it.
I mean, I have to use river rock and all my beds now. I love it.
Well, I was thinking we might put all that lava stone in your driveway.
I did have it in my driveway.
Yeah,
all right, so let's, if I can, Okay, so we'll go with Mr. Fox, we'll go with C, and we'll put it out for first reading with the idea that we may amend it and add D. And let's think about how we want to do that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. We have, we also discussed some no parking, amending the chapter 351 of our truck zoning. We've subsequently come up with an idea. I'd like to push this aside. We're going to have the engineering department to look at a traffic study for the area before we post, or before we adopt legislation regarding this truck parking. That might include the creation of a one-way street. Again, what we're trying to find is a better balance between the needs of the company and its deliveries and a couple of the neighbors. So before we just simply post something, I think the spirit of this is we have a very important commercial citizen, and we should acknowledge that. So before we create a headache for that resident, Rob has graciously agreed to take a look at some other traffic options. So we'll bring this back at another time if that's good.
That's it.
Is that okay?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you for the
all right. Next up, Finance Property, Chairman Warren.
Okay. So we talked about this a lot last week, the professional services agreement between the city of Canton, city of North Canton, and state bill. And we're doing this because we need some help with our building department. And so I would like to thank Pat, Laura, and Tim, and the mayor, and Rob, and kind of everybody who was involved in kind of seeing the issues that we had and concerns, and really finding the company, kind of thinking outside the box, and working with our community to say, hey, this is why we need this, and getting their buy-in with people who are our direct vendors and work with our constituents and different people on our behalf, and looking at all the things that we need. So we did talk about it a lot, and the agreement is in front of you, and it talks about all the services that the company will provide. Well, you can see them on the back, but it says a list of services from plan review, building electrical plumbing services, code enforcement as requested, rental housing, which I know, Doug, you were really excited about, the permit efficient services, building efficient services, etc. So we feel like we have a really good plan in place, and I know that we want to move this forward. Pat, is there anything that you want to talk about more regarding this? Laura, Tim, questions?
I would like to add that conducting the research on this and I've been looking into this for more than a year, bringing it to the present time, what really makes this unique as far as professional service agreement goes is the ability for us to customize in a way that I don't think really anybody else can. So the key points to me were the ability to operate in our domain, in this room, in this building, is where this goes down. So we know what's happening and we're able to maintain the ability to interact with that and make sure that the services are delivered in the manner that are being asked for. Introduction of third-party software that we can utilize even if we were to separate from them down the road. This would be something that we could continue. It's not always the case with someone that you look up and using their software, they take it with them and they go. They're answerable to the administration, so it's not that there is some autonomy with things that are not happening in this building that are happening here, and they report what the problems and concerns that are ongoing. We're able to expand services in a way that this council has been looking for in a couple areas regarding exterior code enforcement and rental registration. They're unique in that they're able to bring that and make that all part of the third-party software. Guaranteed inspection times, not everybody can offer that. That's a biggie for us. Providing an upgrade and automation to the forms that we use hasn't been done. Being able to do it online, electronic plan submission. These are all things that are brought to the table in this area, in addition to community engagement, teaching for residents what they need to do if they need to put on a deck, for instance. We can
respect, I think it's what makes it a pretty unique situation to be able to hit all of those particular items just as we need them.
I think one of the other key criteria is that a chief building officer is assigned to the city of North Canton. Right now is Mark Van Gundy, and Marty is working in our building as the chief building officer and directing the permits and building department. When Marty was out for training a little over a week ago, instead of as with the city employee, if someone is on vacation or they're out sick, there's no one there to be in their seat. Maybe their assistant helps pick up the slack. However, here with the safe belt built agreement, they assigned another person. So they had someone here with the same qualifications as Mr. Van Gundy and was able to offer insight to our zoning board of appeals meeting that had the person been on vacation, we simply wouldn't have been here. Some of the unique things that are available that we weren't able to find in other places is that bit of automation to the process that they bring in their proprietary product, where the permit is an electronic document and the inspector can be out in the field, inspect, say, a plumbing inspection, and input that into a tablet and be able to press a button and send that confirmation that the permit has, the inspection has been completed and the vendor may proceed. It's just simply with a push of the button versus the person coming back, mailing or scanning and emailing the document or asking them to come in and pick that document up. It also covers not just the inspectors, but it covers the permits office, so the permits clerks that we'll have will be safe built clerks. So they undergo a heightened degree of training so that it's not someone that perhaps was an administrative assistant or that type of position and is moved into this spot and kind of learn as they go along. These folks are trained as permit clerks and understand the terms of art that are used, and I think it's going to help speed up the process that we have. There are built-in guarantees that we're not going to find anywhere else. If a permit request is called in before 4 p.m., it's guaranteed that it'll be inspected by the end of business the next day. That's incredible. The plans, both for commercial and residential, are guaranteed to be done in half of what the typical time. Normally, it's expected that it's going to be 30 days. We have a 15-day window for those types of plans. So we believe that this is going to be as best as possible, a seamless transition. And although we haven't placed it on here for emergency legislation, I do think it's something that you may want to contemplate, because full three readings on this, the kind of brief window that we have, I think it runs through the end of...
I was going to suggest it, Tim. Tim, I was going to suggest it.
Because I think that's important. And
yeah, we want to get through
this. We're committed to do this by stating the rationale and the basis for this, because outside of that, our building department that maintains the housing and the building stock for the city comes to a standstill, residents that aren't aware of this, that are expecting inspectors to come out, or jobs cannot proceed without this inspection for electrical before they seal up a wall, or plumbing inspection before they do the same thing. All of those are placed on hold, and you know, thousands of dollars are sitting in day while residents and developers are waiting for our legislative process. I think this fits the bill perfectly for that intent.
Thank you.
So we already put an emergency clause on?
Yes, if you could do that, that would be great. And then we'll move it to the agenda for next week for first reading. But thank you, everyone, for your time. I mean, I think this is something very different than what we're doing in the trial, so if it doesn't, we won't do the thing. But I think so far, we're really pleased with what we're seeing.
I appreciate everybody's efforts. We all want the same thing. We want better looking neighborhoods, code compliance. We've struggled with that. We know, Mayor, we've talked about it. I think this is an opportunity to see this done professionally, effectively, and efficiently. And I'm very excited about it. It's not like we want to penalize people in rental units or own their homes. We do expect a certain standard here, and that's all we're looking for. You know, everybody should be welcomed in our community. With investors and for landowners, you know, private owners, whoever, you know, we owe it to our community to keep our standards and the integrity of our neighborhood sound and sufficient for future years. This is going to do this very happy about us. So thanks for your hard work. Appreciate it.
You know, there's one thing too, you know, when you look at any one of our departments, you see all these departments going through this transition. Because there's really two areas where we're providing the service. There's the people and there's the process. And we've always had very good people in the positions. And if they're not a good fit, it becomes pretty, you know, evident over, you know, a short period of time. So we always try to hire the best people. But one of the limitations that we've had is that we've hired very good people, just in any department. But then the process where we've been lacking, and I think it's common in a lot of government systems, is it depends on your technological advancement. I mean, it's almost like when you're putting together a graduation party. When I look at my son putting his, you know, graduation party together, getting all the names and addresses. Well, once you do it once, and you download all the addresses, it's real easy to get it the second and third time. You go to the computer, you hit the button one time, and you got all the addresses. And that's what we face here, trying to take all the old documents, you know, moving forward and electronically submitting the information, collecting it, and data retrieval. And this company has that all in place. And so now it's just a matter of just using their system, and in this case, their players or their people. But this will be sustainable in the future. Because it'll just take us so much further ahead, you know, of all the other, well, certainly what we have, right? I mean, it's because we're talking about using the iPads, and rather than somebody coming in and, let's say, a developer asking me, or asking the department, you know, when can I have the plan with you? Now there's a timeline, and it can be submitted electronically, right? Reviewed electronically, responded to electronically. Almost like the difference when you go to the bank, normally you have to go into the bank, now you can do it on your cell phone. You can move money on your cell phone, and we just come to expect it. We've been a little bit in the permits department, we've just been behind. But now we're going to be state of the art.
I think there's, to be fair, there are residents that greatly exceed our standard. We have the standard for bonds at no more than 8 inches. Commercial properties no more than 10 inches before they mow the lawn. And we have residents that take great pride in their lawns and their plantings. And some of those individuals are very robust critics of North Canton government. And I think that perhaps they look at it as before I come and criticize, I'm going to make sure that I have my own house in order so that you don't come and criticize, and I'll acknowledge that Mr. Osborne's home, Larry Tripp's home, each of those are frequent critics of city government, but boy howdy, they take care of their homes. You can't find a housing violation, and often there's so much legislation that if you look hard enough, you can almost always find something, but I think with each of them, they take great pride in maintaining their homes. Nearly every day I drive by Larry Tripp's house and I see him either trimming a tree, edging, mowing, raking and mowing his leaves just this afternoon. And I think it's just unfair to those that take that extra effort and know what their standards are and then see that they're not being maintained. It's just a fundamental unfairness to them.
So one quick thing. So what you're saying about all the residents, I agree with. The thing that I see and hear about an awful lot, this is what I was talking to Martin about, our CBO, is that the perception of the past, since it was a little unorganized, we had a lot of bumps and bruises with subcontractors, builders, the BIA, and all those affiliates. And, you know, they always worry about the speed, you know, because how time is money in the construction field, the cost of, you know, registering or, you know, make sure we're in line with the cost. And the third thing is, like, systemization, so that creates the speed efficiency. And so I had a talk with Martin, and he said that he wants to join the BIA, he wants to communicate with them, because we want to sort of bridge that gap of those issues that we had for so many years. And I believe this is a great opportunity for us finally to kind of put everything together, because that's really where we're dropping the ball, I think, with the, you know, our operations. Now that Patrick's been studying this for about a year, and from what I can see, this really looks like a good plan of action. So I'm really excited, and welcome aboard, Martin. We're excited to have you.
And I would be remiss if I didn't point out Melanie Rules. Her house is nearly within sight from our
that's true.
Our council chambers
in Copper.
And it takes great pride in maintaining her home. She's in nearly every council meeting.
Sentinel.
So, again, it's unfair that others aren't maintained and they hold themselves to a higher level, and so they deserve it.
Carol?
I think there's something else that's going on here that's occurred over the last year, and that is sort of fundamental willingness to think out of the box to find greater economies in the way the municipality operates. You know, we pride ourselves on our traditions. But when you think about it, over the last year, we discontinued the mayor's court, which was costing us large sums of taxpayer money. And I think we've achieved the savings here as well, have we not, by taking this approach. So I think it's an example of the municipality's desire to be good stewards of public money. Words get thrown around a lot. This is a case where we downsized, got a little leaner, and I don't know, the aggregate savings of those two actions are big, but I'm going to guess they're about tens of thousands of dollars.
It's very similar to the way that we've, you know, used Rita to collect our income tax, we use Kimball to collect our trash. Sometimes larger organizations have economies of scale that we just can't match.
Yeah.
And what we tried to do with the building department in 2018 staff it up. We thought that would really help improve service and performance, and we basically doubled the size of the department and really saw not a good result. So with SafeBuilt, we will retain some of the revenue, but they take all of the liability, basically. They take the cost of the employees, the technology, the cars, the cell phones, all of those things. So overall, our bottom line.
And I think the other thing is, I would say, is you've reminded us. Sometimes when you start a long path, it takes a great deal of courage to say it's not working. And we're going to stop and we're going to move in another direction. And I think that makes this particular instance particularly good for our taxpayers.
I think the
we haven't enforced certificates of occupancy, haven't been gone over, they haven't been updated. They're ready to go, their system's in place, they're successful with it, so it's just a matter of just putting it in place for us here. That's a calming effect. I'm sure a lot of directors, well, the administration are putting those here. They have a proven system that we're ready for.
We're in 500 municipalities nationwide.
Let's move that on the agenda, an emergency.
Motion to adjourn.
I do.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Aye.
See you next week.
It's only what?
Yeah.